So I'm going to be talking to you this morning about becoming a missionary disciple. Pope Francis talks a lot about it, missionary disciple, intentional disciple. I think those kind of words are bandied around to mean the same thing. So this morning's talk is going to look at three things. What is a missionary disciple and phases of the conversion process? And then, if we have time at the end, our own personal conversion journey and how this might impact our ministry. So we'll start with what is a missionary disciple. I think often in our Palatine parishes, in our talk around the UAC, you know, we're bringing people into groups and into the spirituality of St. Vincent. That's what we're wanting to do. And into people hopefully living their unique apostolate in the world. And I think part of the reason that we struggle so much sometimes to interest people in the UAC is because so many of our people in our parishes and in our church aren't personally converted. They're not missionary disciples. Rather, they're at some point along the pre-discipleship continuum that I'm going to talk about yet later, and they've yet to make a personal, adult and conscious decision to be a follower of Jesus. And so when we talk about Palatine spirituality and universal apostolate, it's something that they just can't really comprehend because it's not something that's in their lived experience. So, you know, in my role, when I had that role as a UAC formation worker, I devoted a lot of my time and energy to programs and retreats and things that were essentially evangelising in nature. People need to be evangelised and to fall in love with Jesus just like St. Vincent did, before they see the value in joining together in apostolate. So this relationship with Jesus comes first, just as it did for Vincent. So I just want to discuss that a little bit further. Conversion is a process that takes place in our lives over a number of stages and over a period of time. And it's not something that happens just once in our lives. It's something that we undergo constantly over the years and in our lives in ever-deepening ways. It's a growing kind of journey. Basically, though, the disciple is someone who has had an experience or an encounter with Jesus and is anxious to tell others about it. Did anyone ever see the movie Contact? It came out in 1997. And it was about an astronomer. It was set in Australia, actually. It was about an astronomer, an atheist. No, it wasn't set in Australia. It's set over in the States. It's about an astronomer and an atheist who made contact with life from outer space via a radio message. And it's a long story, but she eventually travels in space and has an encounter there that leads her to question her previously held beliefs and to really change because of that experience. And what she says at the end of the movie about her experience is interesting as we look at what it means to be a missionary disciple. Now, I've just realised I plugged the speaker in and I didn't check the sound. So...
You're implying that this was all some kind of a hoax, that he engineered this...
Dr. Irwin, you come to us with no evidence, no record, no artifacts, only a story that, to put it mildly, strains credibility. Over $500 billion was spent. Dozens of lives were lost. Are you really going to sit there and tell us we should just take this all on faith?
Please answer the question, Doctor.
Is it possible that it didn't happen? Yes. As a scientist, I must concede that. I must volunteer that.
Wait a minute, let me get this straight. You admit that you have absolutely no physical evidence to back up your story?
Yes.
You admit that you very well may have hallucinated this whole thing?
Yes.
You admit that if you were in our position, you would respond with exactly the same degree of incredulity and skepticism?
Yes.
Then why don't you simply withdraw your testimony and concede that this journey to the center of the galaxy, in fact, never took place?
Because I can't. I had an experience. I can't prove it, I can't even explain it. But everything that I know as a human being, everything that I am, tells me that it was real. I was given something wonderful, something that changed me forever. A vision of the universe that tells us undeniably how tiny and insignificant and how rare and precious we all are. A vision that tells us that we belong to something that is greater than ourselves, that we are not, that none of us are alone. I wish I could share that. I wish that everyone, if even for one moment, could feel that awe and humility and hope. But that continues to be my wish.
So, you know, you've got a copy there of the things that Ellie said. And, the other way, sorry. I had an experience that we're not alone. And I want everyone to share this. And I guess if we're going to be evangelizers, if we're going to spread this good news of Jesus in our lives and in our ministry, we ourselves must have had an experience and feel the urge to share that experience with other people. So Pilotti had an experience of God that he wanted to share. He was driven to share it. And if we're going to be missionary disciples, we have to have had our own experience of God and be willing and even impelled to share that with other people. As evangelizers, we must be convinced that knowing Jesus is the best gift that any person can receive, and that we have encountered Jesus is the best thing that's happened in our lives, and by making him known by our words and our deeds is our joy. And in a way, this might seem really obvious, but research shows that a really high percentage of Catholics in our pews have not had this experience of God. They haven't encountered Jesus as someone that they love intensely and deeply, and that possibly includes quite a lot of clergy as well. So how can we effectively share what we ourselves haven't experienced? I think we can tend to think that in order to kind of rev up our communities and to get people out there evangelizing, that all we need to do is kind of rev them up a bit and reignite this flame of faith that's already there. But actually we need to go further back than that and start with actually evangelizing the people that we have sitting in our pews. Religious, I've got a few statistics here, and they're based in the US, but worldwide in 2010, we saw how fluid religious identity can be. So 16 million people were... Oh dear. Worldwide in 2010, 16 million people were converted to Christianity, and 11.6 million left Christianity. So that meant 27.6 million people moved in and out of Christianity in 1 year. Approximately 53% of US adults have left the faith of their childhood at some point, even if they return to it later. And about 1 in 6 of them will return. That's not a lot, is it? So figures show, actually, that in the US, fully 10% of all Catholics in the people in the US are ex-Catholics. In Australia, at the census, 25% of our population is Catholic. Very low numbers of those people actually practice, but 25% on the census identify as Catholic. That's really high. We live in a society where choosing your faith is normative. Pope Francis has said that we should recognise that in a culture, everyone wants to be the bearer of their own subjective truth, and it becomes difficult for citizens to devise a common plan which transcends the individual. So we live in a culture that actively works against faith and belonging. So people see, and I don't know whether this resonates with your experience, but we live in a culture where people see that faith is something that they choose, that it's their own private business. So people no longer presume that they're going to stay in the faith that they were raised in. And there's this common idea that you choose whether you believe or not, that you choose which church you're going to belong to. Parents these days often won't baptise their children because they wanted to leave it till the children are older so their children could choose. And that's usual and expected these days. So faith is no longer something that's inherited or that's passed down through families. The fastest growing religious group in surveys and censuses now will fill in the unaffiliated or none under religious denomination. So in the US, 19.6% of US adults, or a third of those under 30, would mark themselves as being atheist or agnostic or nothing in particular. So that growth is really getting bigger and bigger. And surveys show that the majority of people who will tick none or one of those boxes are made up of people who were formally affiliated with a faith but never attended. And a lot of them would be Catholics. Only 30% of people who were raised Catholic are still practicing Catholics. And I think actually that number's lower now. In Canada recently, in 2012, I think it was, they did a study of young adults who chose to stay in the church. And what they found was that the people who chose to stay have experienced God's presence and seen answered prayer. So they've had this experience that we're talking about from that movie Contact. They've had an experience and they've seen God working in their lives around them. They can ask and openly discuss their spiritual questions in their parish community. And they understand the gospel at quite a deep level. And they've lived in communities of faith where the older adults authentically live their faith. And so those are the kinds of experiences of young adults who actually stay in church. So that means if we want our young people to stay in our parishes, and if we want the UAC to grow and flourish as an apostolate in the world, we need to become parishes that experience God's presence as being active amongst us and that talk about it, that don't just have it, underneath the presence. We need to talk to each other about it. We need to have religious conversations. Dialogue about questions, not lectures, not homilies, not listening, but actually conversations between people about their faith experiences. So we need to be providing opportunities in our parishes for faith conversations and for scripture study. And we also need to be an example to our young people of a lived and active discipleship. We need to be telling our young people, I had an experience. And I want you to have this too. We're not going to evangelize people by saying, you know, here's the rules or regulations, here's the liturgies. We need to talk about our experience. And are we doing this? Are we doing this enough? Do we share our own experiences, our own stories of feeling God's presence and of experiencing God's presence in our lives? And do we encourage each other to talk about that? And it's really important, I think, that we look at this question, because according to, this is all US statistics, I'm afraid, but according to this Pew Landscape survey, the majority of Catholics don't believe that a personal relationship with God is possible and are still without any explicit personal attraction to Jesus. They only have the capacity to believe that's been placed in them by baptism and the presence of the Holy Spirit. And Lawler says that it's the personal act of faith that transforms a human being from one who can be a believer to one who is a believer, to someone who's on fire and who is compelled to spread that fire. So there's a real lag there. So missionary discipleship then is not unconscious or accidental. It's not something that's cultural that we somehow inherit. It's not following the rules and being good. It's not a transactional relationship. If I do this, well then God will, you know, God will do that and I'll get to go to heaven. It's not a matter of only attending Mass each Sunday. It requires a deliberate decision to follow Jesus as a disciple in the midst of the church. So I guess our question is, what are we doing in our Palatine parishes and missions to facilitate this kind of decision? And that's not doing baptisms necessarily and first communions and confirmations. It's not sacramentalizing people. It's about evangelizing people and helping them to have that experience. And there is a difference. So the next thing I'm going to have a little bit of a look at is phases of the conversion process. What's happening as people come to faith? And I think it can be really important to understand that. So the material that I'm going to be using comes from these books by Sherry Waddell. She's the one that wrote the Called and Gifted Workshop that we've had in this parish a couple of times. But she's done some really interesting work on forming missionary disciples, because she found, as she went around talking, doing this Called and Gifted Workshop, and which encouraged people to examine their experience of being used by God and seeing what, discerning their spiritual gifts for mission, that a lot of people didn't know what she was talking about. And she realised that what was happening was, as we've just been saying, a lot of the people that she was coming in contact with had never heard the kerygma and been evangelised. So in forming missionary disciples, There's different phases of coming to faith and getting to be a missionary disciple. And the first stage is the seeker stage. And within that seeker stage, there's some stages of pre-discipleship that we're going to have a look at in a minute. And then the next stage is the disciple stage. And people that are in the discipleship stage have made a personal decision, have made that personal decision to follow Christ, and they're beginning to form basic habits of discipleship, and they're growing and learning in their faith. And then finally, there's the apostle stage, or the missionary disciple stage. And that's where where people see that they have an apostolate to spread this faith out in the world according to their gifts and where they feel God's calling them. So we're just going to have a look at the personal spiritual journey through the stages of pre-discipleship, because they're the really important ones for our work when we're seeking to encourage people to begin to grow in their faith. And so the stages that people go through are these stages. And they reckon through surveys and things that less than 5% of our church-going communities are these intentional disciples. So the graph looks a little bit like this. We said before that 30% of people that were raised in the church are still active and 70% are inactive. So you would say that they are at the pre-trust stage. So your 30% of active Catholics along that spectrum are along that spectrum there. And they begin with, there's the trust, curiosity, openness, seeking, discipleship. So the initial trust is where we start. And in today's church, I think with all the stuff that's been happening, gaining trust with people is a really huge hurdle. So many of our inactive Catholics have left the church because they've been hurt or because they've been treated badly or have been impacted by clergy abuse scandals, all of those sorts of things. So being able to build trust, to get to know people, to come alongside them, we can no longer assume anymore as a church that just because we're a church that people are going to trust us. In fact, you know, we've almost got to get over a hump of initial distrust in some points. We can perhaps assume that the people who do come to Mass have at least reached the trust level. So people who are developing trust require us to utilise the art of accompaniment that Pope Francis talks about in Evangelii Gaudium. And in this, he says that in the art of accompaniment, ordained ministers and other pastoral workers can make present the fragrance of Christ's closeness and his personal gaze. And this accompaniment, this coming alongside other people as we gain their trust, must be steady and reassuring, reflecting our closeness and compassionate gaze, which heals, liberates, and encourages growth further along the spectrum in Christian life. Accompaniment is not about us, and sometimes we need to be really gentle with people, things like in your playgroup, Georgina, where you just, you know, have people come along and you're just gentle with them as they become part of the community, but we're not pushing them with any faith questions yet. We're just getting to know them and showing them that we love them just because of who they are. And then we kind of hope that people will become to be a little bit curious. And that's the next stage. People in this stage begin to ask questions and to see that faith might mean more than they might have expected, or they might feel a little bit attracted to what it is that we have in our lives and what they see us doing and think, maybe I want to find out a little bit more about that. But somebody that's at the threshold of curiosity isn't open to personal change yet. So the curiosity is kind of passive, but it's more than trust. So the spiritually curious find themselves drawn towards wanting to know more about Jesus and the church and the Bible and the whole Catholic thing, they'll often say. So they ask questions about prayer, about Jesus, about what we're doing and why. And it's not so much question and answer. The important thing, actually, is the questions. So it's the questions and not the answers. And if you think about it, Jesus, he rarely gave a straight answer to a question, did he? You know, who are you? Come and see. You know, what's this? You know, and he'd tell a story. So Jesus welcomed and cultivated curiosity. And in this phase in a person's growing faith, God's using the natural curiosity of the person to help them draw closer to Jesus. So people at this stage can be really hard work, and they can ask question after question. I don't know whether you've ever come across people like that. And we just have to, lots of patience and care and respect. But if you demand a decision of people at this age, you're going to frighten them away. And often when we see people asking these questions, they say, oh, you must be ready to join RCIA, or you must be ready to make a commitment. But they're not anywhere near there yet. They're just at the very beginning stages of beginning to ask questions. The next phase is about openness. And this is a critical point when the person acknowledges to him or herself and to God that they might be open to some personal and spiritual change. And it's one of the most difficult transitions for a modern non-believer because it feels crazy and out of control. So openness isn't a commitment to change, it's just people admitting that they're open to the possibility that there might be some change. And this is the hardest thing for commitment wary people to navigate, because it means that they start to realise that if they're going to continue with this journey into belief, that some choices need to be made. And it dawns on us that we're going to have to be active, that God is not an abstract what or why that they've been asking all these questions about, but a who. A person who's calling to them. But to answer that call is going to mean some stuff. And so can you see how hard that is? If I'm going to answer this call, I might have to change some things in my life. Jesus is going to require something. And in a civilization, in a community, in a culture that's so consumer-driven, you know, we believe, I don't know what your young people are like, but the young people that I know, they like to keep all their options open for as long as possible and make as few commitments as possible. You can't even get them to commit to coming out to dinner on Saturday night until Saturday morning in case something more interesting comes up. They have to keep their options open. So this is a really huge part of it. You know, they realise that if I'm going to do this properly, I've heard people say, I'm going to have to make some changes in my life. Pope Benedict, in his very opening homily as a pope, said, if we open ourselves to Christ, are we not afraid that he might take something away from us? Are we not perhaps afraid to give up something significant, something unique that makes life so beautiful? Do we not risk ending up diminished and deprived of our freedom? In the Called and Gifted workshop, we talk about the please don't send me to Africa syndrome. And we kind of have this idea, I think, even if it's not a conscious thing, that if I say to God, you do whatever you want to do with my life, I really want to follow you. And if we say that, that God will pick the thing that we most hate, the thing that we most don't want to do, the thing that will make us absolutely miserable, and then that's what God's going to ask us to do. We do think that, don't we? You know, the furthest thing. But I love this John Henry Newman quote. John Henry Newman said, God has determined that I should reach that which will be my greatest happiness. He looks on me individually. He calls me by my name. He knows what I can do and what I can best be, and what is my greatest happiness, and he means to give it to me. Pope Francis talks about the joy of the gospel. When we open our hearts to Jesus, it will, and he will ask us to do things that will make us happy and fulfilled. Busy perhaps, but happy and fulfilled. He's not going to make us miserable. And I think that's kind of the biggest question for people in this phase is, or the biggest stumbling block to people really opening their hearts and their lives to God, is this thought that if I do that, I'm going to be asked to do something really miserable. As evangelizers, when people get to this stage, often we can jump the gun push them into something that they're not ready for yet, because this bit can take a fair while. At this stage, what we can do is help them by connecting them to the gospel, maybe, to talk to them about how being open to God in your own life hasn't been a threat to your freedom, but has, you know, been wonderful for you. You know, that personal testimony. Encourage them to pray and ask for God to show them a sign. Encourage them to begin a little bit of a, you know, talking to God. And this is the time that people are ready to maybe come to Mass or begin the inquiry phase of RCIA. It's where they feel that they're being called into a relationship and they're going to have to make a decision. So the next stage then is spiritual seeking. And this is when the person moves from being passive to being someone who actively seeks to know this God. And seekers are kind of asking in their hearts, do I want to give myself to God? Is this what I want to do? So seekers in this stage have this urgent spiritual kind of quest. And, you know, they often find that they can't wait anymore. They have to seek. And they and what they're seeking isn't, you know, religion or theology or music or the Bible or all about the saints or lovely liturgy. What they're seeking is, you know, this core relationship with God. Am I going to commit myself to this God? So they're seeking Jesus, not a creature or an abstraction or even a church. And it's a really, really big place of decision. And this is perhaps, you know, where people are in the RCIA often, you know, when they get to this point. Often people do it through other kinds of things. But to have people around them during this time of making a decision. But it's about a decision to a relationship, not to a church. So having made then that decision, they then are what we call intentional disciples. They've moved into that middle level of discipleship stage. They've made a choice to follow Jesus and a conscious commitment. And at that stage, they're actually ready for baptism if they're adults. And it's the most important decision a person can make, and it's the goal of our Christian life, all of us actually, to keep doing this, not just people being converts. And it's the controlling decision that will drive and coordinate everything. I love this quote from Pedro Arrupe. He said, "Nothing is more practical than finding God, falling in love in a quite absolute final way. What you are in love with seizes your imagination, will affect everything. It will decide what gets you out of bed in the morning, what you do in your evenings, how you will spend your weekends, what you will read, who you know, what breaks your heart, and what amazes you with joy and gratitude. Fall in love, stay in love, and will decide everything." It's an interesting thing to say on Valentine's Day, really, isn't it? So, but if you have a lot of people like this in your parish who are beginning to become intentional disciples, it can lead to some pastoral problems, because if the leaders of the parish aren't intentional disciples, they can get very annoyed and threatened by the commitment of these people and their newly and their growing faith. And they can try and blunt or stymie this move to growth that these, you know, these newly evangelized or newly renewed, you know, renewed people have, by simply, you know, sitting on them a bit, like steady on, you know. A church that has a lot of intentional disciples, a parish that has a lot of intentional disciples in it, are a lot more challenging for the pastor, because the parishioners are less inclined to pay, pray and obey, and will want more spiritual nourishment sometimes than their parish can offer, or they'll start to see where they're called and they'll want to start things up and they'll want to have their own mission within the parish. And if the parish can't engage with these people and actively promote their growth and encourage them, they're going to go where their growth can be supported and nurtured. They're going to go somewhere else. And I've seen that happen again and again in parishes. I'm not talking about here. But people that have this kind of journey and feel really unsupported in their local parish, and they end up going somewhere else where they feel their faith is more supported. So people that become intentional disciples, they worship and pray and give and study and discern, not out of guilt, not out of feeling that they have to, not out of duty, but out of a living and growing relationship with God. And it looks markedly different to people who are doing it out of a sense of cultural duty. So it has really big implications in a parish for stewardship, attendance, evangelisation, vocations. People who have reached the discipleship stage are hungry for catechesis and Bible study. They're hungry, they develop a new appreciation for the sacraments and Mass. And they're starting to actively discern then how they might actively live their faith in the world and become apostles or missionary disciples. So in this continuum that we looked at the start, you know, people have moved up to becoming disciples. So how do we foster this growth in our through these stages in our parish community? When we're designing a faith formation program, so often we just have things that that are catechesis up here. But catechesis really only works when you've got people in the seeking to discipleship stage. So what you need are things in your community that are pre-evangelising, that are about listening and caring and just coming alongside people. So, you know, in the school, that's things like all the stuff that happens in schools where people get involved in the community. It's in the parish, you know, the cuppas after Mass, the just drawing people in and getting to know them. Then you need to have something that's not catechesis, but is an initial proclamation of the kerygma, which is just the very simple beginnings of what it is that we believe as Christians. Who is Jesus? Why did he die? Teaching people how to pray, talking about the Bible, and encouraging them to say, if you're going to be part of this, you need to make a decision. The Alpha course is very good at doing that. It doesn't do that, it does this. Playgroup, you know, as I said, things in the school, playgroups, social events, they're good at those sorts of things. So we need to be quite conscious when we're planning a parish a formation program that we include all these different areas, because if we just have catechesis, it's not going to reach this very big percentage of people in this pre-discipleship continuum, because you're speaking to them at a level that they're just not at and they're just not going to hear it. So when we get to the discipleship stage, then there's a further crucial stage that we're entering into, and that is becoming apostles. So we've made the decision to follow Jesus. We're learning more and more about him through Bible studies and catechesis and coming to Mass and getting involved in the sacraments more. And we're growing closer to Jesus, but we're also starting to realise that there's another step, and that is, where is God actually calling me? And that's where we get to, you know, to become apostles. You know, so the discernment of our vocation and the sense that we need to live what God wants us to do in the world. So when I talk about being an apostle, I don't mean going out and preaching. It means living our lives that we feel God's calling us to. And then by how we're doing it is how we reach other people. A parasita, which is a document that was pretty much written by the Pope when he was one of the bishops in South America. Parasita reminds us that mission is inseparable from discipleship, so it mustn't be understood as a stage subsequent to formation, although it is carried out in different ways depending on your own vocation. So discipleship and mission are like two sides of the one coin. And I think it's at this stage where, in the faith formation spectrum, where membership of the UAC becomes really relevant for people. So Pilotti had this vision of a universal apostolate and of helping people who were on fire for Jesus, who had met this Jesus that Pilotti was so in love with and formed a relationship with, and were looking at, how can I live this in the world? And that's what the UAC and Pilotti's vision of it is all about. It's encouraging people to find what their mission is and to go out and do that in the world, often together, often in our own ways, and then meeting together as UAC communities and sharing and encouraging and supporting each other. Does that kind of make sense? Yeah. So we're looking here at, you know, the UAC kind of fitting in this spectrum to people that have made a decision and are wanting to have encouragement and support to discern and live their call in the world. So I guess if we're really serious then about living St. Vincent's charism in the UAC, and if we're really serious about this great commission in Matthew's gospel, you know, about making disciples, go out and make disciples of all the world, then you know, if we told the story of Jesus' death and resurrection, if we systematically challenge people about where they are in this faith journey, if we celebrate and support new disciples in an ongoing way, if we sent out fully formed missionary disciples to live their discerned vocations in the world, what would our parishes look like? What would our world look like? And I think that's where we've got this vision of Pilotti to kind of set the world on fire. It's, you know, these people who have, you know, who just really want to go out there just like Pilotti did. And he was on fire, wasn't he? He was the most amazing person. And that was his vision, wasn't it? This group of people that would help each other to really live their vocations, to not be afraid, to trust that what God wants for them is something that's going to make them happy. So we could really begin to make Pilotti's and Pope Francis's vision a reality. And I guess, you know, the challenge then is, are we really serious about making apostles and missionary disciples in our parish community? And how might we do that? And I think we might, because we've got Mass coming up now, we might just have a little bit of a questions or discussion or anything that kind of struck you in that. There was a third little part of the talk about our own faith journey, but I think that might take a little bit long to do this morning. So, yeah, any questions or responses or...